This is a very special event in a very special city with very special people. What you see outside and what you enjoy is the result of planning for an entire year.
On behalf of the city of Bethlehem, I would like to welcome everyone to the 35th Annual Musikfest. Years ago, Musikfest started with humble roots and the uncertainty of a second year. And over the next 10 days, we will gather to celebrate our love of music, for Musikfest is a catalyst that brings us together to share our great city with people from all over the United States and the world.
Ladies and gentlemen, join me on the dance floor for the chicken dance and let the fest begin.
Musikfest is not just the largest non-gated music festival in the country. It is a symbol of what this community has come together to do for 35 years.
Hello, I'm PBS39 host Grover Silcox, and welcome to the Story of Musikfest. During our program, we'll tell you why Musikfest began and how it became one of the nation's largest free music festivals and how it continues to grow and evolve. Sit back and enjoy as the festival comes to life.
The Story of Musikfest is made possible by contributions to this PBS station by viewers like you. Thank you.
The Moravians, a religious group from Germany, settled in Pennsylvania along the Lehigh River in 1741 and established the city of Bethlehem. During the Industrial Revolution, Bethlehem became a center of steelmaking and home to Bethlehem Steel, the second largest steelmaker in the nation.
People grew up in this town expecting to work for Bethlehem Steel, go away to college and work for Bethlehem Steel in the offices. Whether you got a job in the offices or in the plant, it was a job for life. So let me go back to the dark years of the late 70s when Bethlehem Steel, which was the major industry in this community, and then all of a sudden, things started to crack.
Decline of the steel industry across America had taken hold, and Bethlehem Steel was reducing employment.
When I first came to the Lehigh Valley, I was with another accounting firm and actually conducted the audit of Bethlehem Steel for 3 years. So I saw what was going on at the steel, and it was a time when it was very difficult for the organization and for the company overall.
Layoffs started in some of the plants, but the big day in Bethlehem was in September 1977. Which was to this day called Black Friday.
It was the first big wave of job losses.
And then we had your second Black Friday, they called it, massive layoff at Bethlehem Steel. So it was evident to everyone that Bethlehem Steel was not going to be here forever.
And by 1983, Bethlehem was kind of hanging by a thread. Here I am on a tourism committee, and they're saying, we need to do something to bring people to the downtown. They said, why don't we do an event in August? That was the start of where Musikfest evolved. I came up with the idea of having a music festival, not because I'm an expert in music, but because music is part of the tradition of this community. Bethlehem has music in its blood. Moravians worshiped with music. They still today have a worship service called the Singstunde, which is a song hour, and all the worship is simply singing. The Moravians also led to the founding eventually of a lot of musical institutions, including the Bach Choir. Came up with the idea of naming it a German name, Musikfest with a K, because we wanted to call attention to the Germanic heritage of the community. So the first year, we had a budget proposal. which is really funny today, of $100,000. But in 1983, that was a heck of a lot of money. And we needed the city to approve about $40,000 worth of services. And what we meant by that was street cleaning, garbage removal, police, sanitation, all those things. First, the mayor, Mayor Paul Marcinson, presented this to his cabinet.
I asked him how much money did they have to start with. He said, nothing. And I said, how many sponsors did you have? He said, none. And I said, whoa, no sponsors, no money. I mean, that doesn't look too good. So I went to my staff, so I put it up to a vote, and naturally, it lost 8-2.
The business administrator says, this could bankrupt the city. Are you kidding me? And the city solicitor says, I don't think this is a good idea, and so on, right down the line to the entire cabinet. And he comes to the mayor's administrative assistant. She said, something's got to happen around here. Something's got to change. You ought to give this young man a break. The mayor promptly just says, we're going to do it.
I was always close to my dad. And in 1983, we had several personal conversations that went basically like this. He goes, Rob, we're in a recession. Bethlehem Steel just went from 15,000 workers to 6,000, laying off 9,000. I just guaranteed a music festival, that they could have 100% support of the city, including sites, manpower, police, you name it. He says, am I crazy? But I want to say one thing. He kept saying over and over, if we get sponsors and if we get volunteers, it will work. They're worried about this and they're worried about that and who's going to sing and who's going to dance. It will work.
Well, I got involved with Music Fest based on a phone call that I had with Jeff Parks back in 1983. And I said, what day in August? He said, no, not one day. He said, it's going to be 9 days. I said, so a 9-day festival, 8 locations in August. Yep. And then his final comment was, and oh, by the way, all the music's going to be free. Well, my initial reaction to Jeff was that I really couldn't believe that we were going to try and put a festival together in downtown Bethlehem, and I think his two words to me were, trust me.
The first check we received was from B. Braun, which is a German maker of medical equipment that was here in Bethlehem, and it was for $3,000.
James Barr is the president of First National Bank.
First National Bank of Allentown actually spent about $176,000 on the first Music Fest, including most of the marketing. And that was an enormous sum back then.
I think the most important thing to say about it is proof once again of what this community can do when it pulls together in a common cause. Thank you and enjoy the day.
The next person I went to that was successful was a gentleman named Frank Banco. He was one of the largest beer distributors in the country. We formed a partnership. I'll never forget what Frank Banco said the first time I visited him, and I still get choked up talking about this. He said, anything for Bethlehem.
Jeff had the idea, and with Dad by his side, Dad was able to get the beer sponsor for Music Fest that year, which was Stroh's. Then also, because of his connections with the Liquor Control Board, he was able to help Jeff get the license that he needed.
We had to change the law, but with Frank and his contacts, there was a special occasion permit amendment that literally was called the Music Fest Law, that a nonprofit engaged in the arts in a city of the third class during the month of August could get a special occasion permit for up to 10 days.
So it was pretty instrumental in helping Jeff get everything done that he needed to get done to get Music Fest started.
So the first year of Music Fest, I needed people to be site supervisors. Now, I needed people who knew how to organize a little bit.
Jeffrey and I knew each other for a long while. Jeffrey and I were involved in politics together. So I was the district judge, and he would come up to my office and said, hey, have a minute, can I talk to you? I said, sure. He said, we're gonna have a party, I need your help.
And Jim agreed to take the big tent, the Festplatz tent.
Would you like to run a tent? I'll give you all the volunteers, give you everything you need. I just need a good supervisor.
And he just embraced that role tremendously.
I pulled some of my neighbors together, pulled them in, and asked them if they wanted to help. They cheerfully volunteered, not knowing what they were getting into. In fact, the one, Paul Fissner, is 35 years with Musikfest.
So Jim recruited everybody, friends, neighbors, families, anybody walking through the neighborhood. And I think there were five of us from the neighborhood that first year. Jim says, come on down, tap beer. Don't worry about the details. The rest will take care of itself.
On behalf of the citizens of Bethlehem, I am delighted to welcome each of you to the grand opening of Musikfest 84.
We want you to all enjoy, have a good time, and celebrate this beautiful weather, the joy of music, and also the joy of the birth of a new industry in the Lehigh Valley called tourism.
I don't know that people really knew what to expect. Nine days of festival activities, music throughout the community. All of it free, food vendors. Beverage, beer, soda.
Word got around that there was this thing going on in downtown Bethlehem.
Welcome to Musikfest 84.
And people were curious. So they came out and they had a great time.
I think it's great, a festival site that is nothing else but that. So it's kind of almost like a little city for a weekend.
We were down the German place down there, German music. I loved it.
It's friendly.
Yeah, people are friendly.
Come together.
You know, I'll tell you the truth, they came for the beer.
That's good too.
Doing just fine, just like the entire city of Bethlehem and the Lehigh Valley of Pennsylvania. The day, the week, it's the highlight of our history. We should be very proud.
I hate to say it, but our first year, we were about as organized as a church picnic. So every night, the end of the night, we get together and think, wow, what didn't work this time? And every day, we just try to make it a little bit better than it was yesterday. We kept changing. And after a couple of days, we made it work.
The first year of Musikfest, there were about 182,000 people that attended over the first 9 days of the festival.
Which was stunning. It was a major success story to have that many people in downtown Bethlehem in August 1984.
It was 9 days of absolutely perfect weather, and it was a rounding success in terms of the impact on the community.
The arts have a unique way to bring the community together. And 1984's first event demonstrated that completely, that the community found an excuse to get out of their social halls and come together. It was community therapy.
For 35 years, Musikfest has offered local artists a platform to showcase their talents and a place for national and international artists to bring their music to new audiences.
This year marks my 29th year performing at Musikfest, something I'm very proud about.
Yeah, I got one kind of favor I'm gonna ask of you. I've got one.
Musikfest has given us all countless opportunities to present our music, and it can be in all different forms too. You'll see us do an acoustic or me do a nice soft solo stuff, and then come out and we're playing Hendrix and Cream. I love it all. It's given us all us musicians in the area and beyond the area, the opportunity to bring our music here and reach new audiences.
There's two white horses following me. When it's two white.
One of the most amazing things that stands out to me is the very first time I played, 1989. We were at Liederplatz, which is the small stage behind the Sun Inn. My father was sitting in the front row of that show. My mother was ill, so she was able to see it at home on the television. And my dad was sitting there in the front. And 3 weeks later, my dad dropped dead of a heart attack. And shortly after that, I received the television video, and panning across the audience, numerous times throughout, was my dad. I get to see my dad all over again, big smile on his face, really enjoying the show, and that meant so much to me. Still does.
Platz is a square. It's German. We wanted people to feel like they were going from one Platz to another, where they would experience different music and different food as part of their experience. And of course, we couldn't change the surroundings. We could only put up new tents and so on. But it was that idea that people got to not only explore the downtown, but explore different music and food as they went from Platz to Platz.
The original main stage was a venue called Kunstplatz in a cement band shell that Bethlehem Steel donated to the city.
One of the two original sites that's still in Musikfest, Liederplatz, Sun Inn Courtyard, Festplatz is down at the Colonial Industrial Quarter. The others have all changed.
I was at the main site called Festplatz, and it was a German theme. It was basically a big polka tent. If you know
it, sing along. Was rooted in the music of the region and rooted in the music of the greatest generation. It was my parents' generation, the World War II folks. Polka was the unifier because polka was a fun, lively dance thing, and it was done all in the social halls of the south side of Bethlehem. So it was able to bring people together. We always had three generations of people on that dance floor dancing together, and sometimes four. You could bring grandma, you could bring your children, you could bring your grandchildren.
In Himmel, da gibt's kein Bier, drum trinken wir es hier. In heaven, there's no beer. The dance floor was always crowded with people dancing polkas and singing, roll out the barrel, all that stuff, you know. It was a happy affair.
That's what they made.
Walter Groller is a Lehigh Valley fixture. He represents the Pennsylvania German community and has performed at every music fest as the polka show that he is. He's a legend, he's an icon.
I was nominated into the Polka Hall of Fame in 1986. We won a Grammy nomination in 1987. This is the Linney Award, which is my recent treasure.
From the first year on, it was wonderful to see people embracing their grandchild, running around the dance floor, and of course, ultimately, doing the chicken dance, which is a whole nother conversation.
I was in Regensburg, Germany, and they had an Oktoberfest over there, and they were doing this dance. I couldn't figure this out, you know, they were moving their hands, and at first it was kind of funny to watch. So I had a friend and I asked him what this dance was. He said the Vogeltanz, which means the bird dance. And when I come back, we did it at Musikfest. That's the first time we played it there. And they start dancing, called it the chicken dance. That's where it came from. And then the chicken lady, and that was a big thing.
It's the people, the music, that actually energizes you and makes you want to do the chicken dance.
Walt would close the festival every year. Pat Hollitz, the chicken lady, and I got together for one last chicken dance on the stage in front of a throng, usually of college students, so I never understood why they went for the chicken dance. And then Walt would go into his patriotic group of songs, and that was the big climax to the festival every year.
Yeah! Our type of music kind of brings a happiness to the crowd. It almost makes everybody forget their worldly problems. They kind of forget that when they get out on the dance floor and start jumping around there. They diminished polka at the festival. Mostly the older crowd that comes there, a middle-aged older crowd, yeah, they were upset because they were really into the polka music. And because today the rock music is very popular and they have that down there too. But I would say don't diminish the polka music because that's a big part of the festival.
Well, now they've made it a multi-music tent. Times have changed. So they still bring polkas in. They bring in some hard rock. They bring in some country. Yeah, I think it's working. Not that I was totally in favor of it, because, you know, I started Festplatz. You know, it was Jimmy's Boom Boom Room. It was the polka tent. But, and by the way, I don't know how to dance the polka.
Polka plots, and now it has evolved because you've got a new generation of people that are into rock and roll and all other genres of music, and it's evolved and it's changed.
You hear some people say, I wish we'd have more polkas, but you know, times have changed. We're producing a festival now to a different age bracket.
We're not a polka festival, we're not a folk festival. We can evolve, and the beauty to me is that the festival has evolved in so many different ways.
Light it up, let's get this show on the road.
One of my all-time highs was sort of 25th anniversary. At Volksplatz, our three top-drawing acts in those days were Mamma Jamma, the Red Elvises, and Brother. As a 25th anniversary celebration, all three were booked on the same evening, back to back to back. So we had a party that started at 5 o'clock and ran right to 11.
There's Farner and Supertramp and Kansas and keep coming back. These nostalgia acts have a home at Musikfest and they get great crowds.
So Squirrel Nut Zippers will be on a free stage. Marshall Crenshaw Band will be on a free stage. You wouldn't see that at other festivals.
We were asked to play Musikfest, me and my husband were beyond stoked, and it was kind of that weird moment where we felt like we made it. I mean, this is our local Musikfest, you know, which to us at that point in time was just as exciting as playing on Jimmy Fallon or something.
I was barely 22 when I started.
I believe that Musikfest is elevating our local music community because while people might be coming to Musikfest for the headliners, for specific musicians, they're also inadvertently coming to see local acts that are supporting those musicians. So even if people aren't going to specifically see their local artists, they're going to see them anyway, and they're going to start being familiarized with those band names, with those people, and it's just helping everything grow.
At the core of Musikfest are the volunteers. From beer and ticket sales to trash pickup and stage setup, they are the engine that drives the festival.
We can have up to 500 volunteers a day at the festival. When I first started here, I learned the most about the festival from talking to the volunteers. They truly run this festival. They run sound and audio. They will make sure the performers know where to show up, get their mic check done. They're doing traffic, trash, ticket booths. They have started the festival, and they continue to be the ones that help direct and run it every single year.
You know, when you volunteer, you can make as much or as little of it as you want. But if other people are thinking of volunteering, you know, you don't have to make a year-round, full-fledged commitment. You could just come, get your shirt, volunteer for three shifts during Musikfest.
Musikfest pulls from 46 states and 6 countries. So it is truly an international event that comes to celebrate all things Bethlehem and all things music. And food. Food is big there too.
You always have your standards, your gyros, your tacos, and those are the standards.
A lot of people do come down for food and beverage, and they look forward to that. The Bethlehem Dairy Stores, strawberry, the waffles, ice cream. Obviously, the aw shucks corn is, you know, everyone's looking for that.
A lot of people enjoy the corn. We do have three stands, so it's scattered around to give people a chance to enjoy it.
Aw shucks corn is one of the festival favorites. They literally roast corn, and they have a secret ingredient and a secret recipe that include butter and Parmesan and then these little spices. It is absolutely fantastic. It's a perfect festival food because you can pick it up, walk around, eat it.
You never get a bad ear of corn ever. It's so good.
And we always try to put something new in each year to change it up a little bit and market that.
We've had alligator on a stick, ostrich. One of my all-time favorites was at Volksplatz a number of years ago, scrapple on a stick.
Okay, ArtsQuest is a nonprofit organization that we do treatment for people that struggle with addiction, drug and alcohol addiction. It's a free program. We don't receive any funding from the government at this moment, so everything that we do in CREA is free of cost for the participants. Yes, we've been here since 1985 doing the Music Fest. This is our biggest fundraising event in the year. We look forward every year to do this, yes.
In addition to the food, there are other traditions at Music Fest that run the gamut from t-shirts to television.
This is a Musikfest 1984 shirt, the very first year. My contribution to the marketing was people have to know that there's beer and music. So you can see beer and music. That was the whole deal.
The Musikfest mug is a collector's item. It started with pitchers. We sold pitchers of beer instead of mugs. We quickly learned that was probably a bad idea. So we reduced that down to the 24 ounces today. And what I love about that is that each year you put the Musikfest poster design on it. Those designs are done by local artists, regional artists. This year we have a tattoo artist who's doing it. So we're able to go out to an artist and say, give us your interpretation of what Musikfest means to you.
Ready, four, and start your move, mix four. Take four and I go, ready, one.
Service Electric TV 2 has broadcasted since 1984, starting with its humble beginnings in here at Festplatz. Three cameras and a host out in the midway to where it's evolved to multiple sites on two channels, up to 208 hours of live programming in addition to taped programming. Each one of those shows could consist of five, six cameras, you know, per show. In 1984, I was in high school working for Service Electric as what we call a utility. Kid pulling cables around, helping the camera guy set up, doing whatever you needed to do to help make that broadcast possible. And I've seen it evolve from day one to where we are today. And now, you know, spearheading the production that our viewers are able to see on TV, it's kind of neat. With Jeff Parks and his vision started Musikfest, it came hand in hand with what our philosophy has always been, to give the community something that they didn't have the opportunity to do. So we jumped on board from day one and have been there ever since.
Venues are tweaked, venues are upgraded and changed, entertainment has changed, we're trying new genres. These are the kind of chances that the organizers are taking, and some of them pay off, some of them don't.
So when I first started here, the whole festival was on the north side. There were sites going all the way up through Main Street onto Broad Street. The Broad Street was a plaza at that time. And then over the years, that opened up, and the sites moved down to the lower areas, to Sand Island, moving the main stage from what was called Kunstplatz on Moravians Field to River Place.
Given the oddities of Bethlehem, you know, we're a city in two counties, and the river divides us in between with two downtowns. And our long-term objective was to get to the south side.
Then we expanded here to the south side at Steel Stacks in 2011.
The campus over here, the ArtsQuest Center, was built, and the lots here, splitting the festival in two and moving the main stage over here, which was the best thing we've ever done.
The south side has, I think, a little more elbow room. It's got indoor stages at the ArtsQuest Center, and it's got the only ticketed venue in the Sand Steel stage. So it's a different vibe.
I think that's one of the best venues we have now from an entertainment standpoint.
festival actually covers over 57 acres within the city. So we're literally building the city within the city for those 10 days.
It's a year-long process.
The week before the festival is just chaos, if you look at it, but it's organized chaos.
We store a lot of stuff in tractor trailers. They get delivered, and we start unloading that and working with different companies.
4 weeks before the festival starts, our technicians are out here running cable, fiber optic lines, getting all the infrastructure in place to interconnect all the tents and office trailers and everything.
Tents, tables, chairs.
The police, our staff, our corporate partners.
Food vendor, electrical, sound, lights, power for all of these plazas.
There is a groundswell that comes together to put this on.
The joke usually when I first start here was, what do you do after those 10 days? It's a day-by-day process. We have a schedule each day of what we want to accomplish, along with who's coming in and setting up. And it is a layered process, so because some things have to be done before other things, depending on size, when they get delivered and get fitted in like a little jigsaw puzzle until it all comes together at the end. We're almost 200 tents, roughly, at the festival. Not including the main stage, which is about 6,500 chairs alone. There's another 7,000 chairs that go out there. There's another about 200 portalettes.
Everything depends on the weather and how much beer is going to be sold. Last year was a very good year, so we did approximately 1,300 half barrels and 1,900 cases, which would round out to about 25,000 gallons of liquid.
But last year, Jeff and I were at a ticket booth on Main Street. There were so many people that came up to the ticket booth and wanted to know how the system worked, which tells me that there were an awful lot of people who were coming for the first time, which 35 years later is still very exciting.
What I think has changed over time is the size and scope of the festival and the amount of partners that we have involved to help pull this off. So to me, that's been a significant change over the last couple of years.
Musikfest, obviously over the early years and still to this day, has a fair amount of complainers because, you know, anytime you shut down the middle of a city and bring in a million people over 10 days, you're going to have parking issues, you're going to have congestion issues, you're going to have noise. So therefore, people will always have complaints and grievances about it. You know, having been in politics and government life for 25 years in Bethlehem and the Lehigh Valley, you come to know that there's no good idea that doesn't meet with a lot of resistance and opposition.
A lot of people say that Music Fest has changed so much over the years, and it isn't what it used to be, and there's so many out-of-towners and so many strangers, and I do get it. But I think it's the constant change and the constant evolution is the reason Music Fest is still around 35 years later.
People from all walks of life come to the festival. There's no barriers to entry. There's no way that people feel that they're not welcome, which we've really worked on very hard over the years. We've programmed music for different communities that would also be something that the rest of the community might be interested in. We started programming specifically for the Latino community in 2000. That was all a deliberate effort to bring what was a growing portion of our community into the major festival in the city and have them be a part of it.
As Latinos growing up in Bethlehem, yes, we knew Music Fest was there, we knew it was happening, but I didn't feel at the time that it was for the Latino community.
And we were just really happy to play even the smallest of parts in Music Fest history. You can thank our mother, Delia Rivera Diaz. She gave my brother and I no choice to come with her.
She said there's a meeting. They're discussing what to call this new plaza that's going to focus on Spanish music, and you guys have to go. So we had to go.
It was just part of her commitment to the community. She was so active in the South Side. She loved her Latino brethren, so that's why she brought us down.
We got here, and we were the only ones that showed up. I think there was one other gentleman there, right? We started off thinking this was Latino music, so we were throwing around words like Latino plots or Latin plots. And
And we kept throwing out these Latino names. He's like, well, we're gonna have reggae and we're gonna have stuff like that, different Caribbean music. So we said, what about Caribbean plots? And Jeff Parks was kind of like, eh. And I think I said, well, it's all tropical, tropical. And he said,
tropical.
And Jeff went, bam, and that was it.
What a wonderful feeling it was to see that entire area filled with people that look like me, that talk like me, that like the same things that I like on the most basic fundamental levels.
Wow. We were like, we were in shock, because like I said, it was always waltz plots. When they developed Plaza Tropicana and we went down there to see, it was incredible, really nice. It's always a great crowd there, the mixture of different people, and the energy is incredible. The dancing, the applause especially. We get great response from the people, and they love our music.
Every summer for 35 years, the city of Bethlehem has invited folks to come and share in the joy, revelry, and excitement of Music Fest. It's an invitation that has drawn people from all over the nation and has helped make Bethlehem and the Lehigh Valley a remarkable destination.
This is Bethlehem's festival, and we own it, and I think everybody in the city is very proud of it.
The economic impact that Music Fest has, ArtsQuest has, year-round is just so much stronger than just these 10 days. It really is such a unique situation that we have here in the Lehigh Valley that we call home.
To me, the success story is that we are attracting the people that you need for the successful businesses that are in the Lehigh Valley, and many of them are choosing to live in Bethlehem because it's so culturally rich. That's the success story. That was the goal all the time.
It has spurned arts, entertainment, economic development. It's keeping some of our young folks in town and in the Lehigh Valley.
Go down there and be a part of it. That's the most important thing you can do. Go down there and join the fellowship of your neighbors and the whole crowd. Be a part of it. It's a fun thing. Good, clean, fun.
35 years now. That's a hell of a run. I hope it goes another 35 years. It's one of the best music festivals in the country. And I'm proud I was ahead a little bit in the beginning of that festival. I'm a very proud guy about Music Fest.
Every year I have that moment where you just see people laughing and hugging and, oh, how you have been? I haven't seen you since last Music Fest. You know, and an adult beverage in hand, the music is playing in the background, the aroma of all the great food, the smoke coming off the grills. And that is about as lighthearted and carefree, life is good, the world is good.
It's not too often that somebody has a dream and they can see it to its full fulfillment.
Music Fest has the opportunity, as long as the community continues to embrace it, to continue to bring the community together. And whatever form that takes is up to the future generations. I think it's got many years ahead of it. It can be whatever they want, and that's what's really cool about this festival.
My hope for Music Fest is that it remains a bedrock of community support, that it continues to reflect the strength of our community, the involvement of our community, but that it also finds those new and emerging artists, those new and emerging experiences, and brings those to the Lehigh Valley.